This seance was recorded on the 26th of September. Medium as it stands.
We should see.
The kitchen.
Yes.
You didn't get much attention here.
I say, you don't go to concerts very often.
Not to our venue.
No. I know you're more on the operatic side.
Yes,
no,
we are. Yes.
The recording have you got? Come.
We haven't got a whole one. Well, we have the famous ones of Ancel off the air.
But where did Doyle's English?
No, we... No, I know she's very good, but we haven't got her.
Oh, well, it's made of opinion taste, I suppose. You're much more interested in the old singers, I'm told.
On the whole, yes, I think Thomas Beecham is a wonderful singer, of course.
And if you were Henry Wood.
Oh, I know Henry Wood.
I'm not going to pay the here today. As a matter of fact, there's a whole crowd of souls here who frankly, well, some of them I had great regard and respect for when on your side, some of them I knew personally, some of them I had much time for, but one learns to appreciate, one changes, you know. I changed, I suppose, to some extent.
Have you, yes.
And some people probably would say for the better. I'm not quite as caustic as I used to be.
I know, I guess.
I used to be a little more patient and tolerant, but I didn't stand fools gladly.
Because
I look back and I have my regrets, who doesn't?
Who doesn't?
Might say differently in some respect. Because I hadn't all that much time for opera, you know. Not really.
No. You don't surprise.
The singers used to get in the way. I'm exaggerating.
Yes. Sir Thomas, you didn't know the truth of communication when you were on this side.
Well, I had some regard knowledge of it. I had quite a bit of experience because I knew Doyle, you know.
You knew Doyle?
Didn't all see eye to eye, but had great regard and respect for him.
Yes.
A man like that could accept, well, there must be something in it.
Yes.
And
yes,
I did have one or two experiences of my own, you know.
Yes, we realised.
Have you ever read any books about it? No, my friend. I've heard so much about you two girls.
How nice.
Good heavens, yes. Well, from one and another over here, you know, you're most popular in the musical world.
Oh, well, we've always loved.
Of course, I don't know if you believe all this business about coming over here in your sleep, but there's no getting away from the absolute fact that often a person during their so-called sleep is temporarily can be released from the body and travel into conditions far removed from the material. I understand several of your friends here that you spend quite a bit of time, if I can refer to time in that sense over here, and you've attended concerts and you've attended theatres and operas and you've met so many of your old friends. Can you hear me?
Yes, now we hear you. You're very clear.
It's very difficult to hang. Can you hear?
Yes.
I don't think you'll work, which you probably will. If you, when you do eventually get here, probably want to make a return occasionally, but you'll find how jolly difficult it is.
I'm sure, yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we hear you. Yes. Can you hear us?
Well, yes and no. That sounds so stupid, doesn't it? Actually, yes, I do, but the strange thing is, before you enunciate words, I'm conscious, not always, but invariably, I'm conscious of your thoughts.
Yes.
I almost know exactly what you're going to say. Perhaps the phraseology may be a little different, but it's an extraordinary thing.
Yes.
Now, you see, you take me, for instance.
Yes.
I'm standing here in front of this apparatus, the box business, whatever you like to call it, and I have to sort of press, is the only way I can explain this, myself into it.
Yes.
But it's not so much what I do in a physical sense, if I can use the word physical, because it is a kind of physicalness entering into your entire vibrational condition, but it's what I have to think.
Yes.
I had to transmit my thoughts.
Yes.
And that, in some strange way, I don't quite know, the apparatus responds or reacts and vibrates your vibration or your atmosphere, and you hear what I'm thinking.
Yes.
In a sense, I suppose artificially, you might say, transmitted into sound waves.
Yes.
Of course, this is one of the things that I have found most fascinating and interesting over here, is the vibration.
Yes.
Because all musical life is vibration.
Yes.
Nothing is quite what it seems. In your work, for instance, everything appears solid and tangible, and you can touch it, you can, if it's a jar, you can sit on it or whatever, but it's all vibration.
Yes.
And of course we are vibrating, you know, at a very different rate in our own environment.
Yes.
That's why you don't see us.
Yes.
And why if we can enter into a room, we don't necessarily have to open the door, we can walk through it. It's
yes,
no longer
quite
solid to us.
Yes.
While we're lowering our mentality and our vibration and entering into your consciousness, as it were,
yes,
of things material,
yes,
so we can enter and become part temporarily, in a way, of your life.
Yes.
It may not be in a solidified sense, but in a mental sense, it's been a real thing. You know?
Yes.
Because over here, I've learned a great deal about vibration. It fascinates me. Because over here, we have instruments which are bigger description. I mean, I wouldn't even know how to begin to describe them. I mean, orchestras here can consist of hundreds and hundreds of players playing some instruments which, of course, would be very familiar to you, like the violin and the cello or what have you, and there are other instruments. And of course, the great artists of the past, great composers, for instance, great singers, whoever it happens to be in that particular field, has the opportunity to continue here and look at the composers. New works have been composed by Beethoven and Chopin and all manner of kind of people. New operas have been brought into being and are performed in vast auditoriums, vaster than any you can imagine. But of course you see everything here, although it is physical in as much as it's tangible. In other words, you can see various things and you can touch them and they appear solidified, solid, etc. Yet everything is of mental nature. I mean, don't think for one moment that you can just sit down and visualize something and there it is. It's not quite like that. In other words, if you are a creative artist, you don't suddenly create it by thought alone. You have to put thought into action.
Yes,
we have substances here which is as real to us as yours are to you.
Yes.
I'm not going to say that we have wood or that we have cement quite in the same meaning or sense that you understand it. But what I do want to convey is that we do have a reality of a world, a solidified world, a world which is as real to us as yours is to you.
Yes.
And while we enter into that atmosphere and condition and thought force and vibration, so it is temporarily at least until such time as we release ourselves and go into a different level of consciousness or a different plane or a higher condition of life, then that remains our home, that remains our world, it remains our state of being.
Yes.
You know, there are thousands, absolutely thousands upon thousands of worlds.
Yes.
Not just two or three. I've heard some of these people in your world, the spiritualists you call them, who talk about spheres. Well, that's all right, it's another way of expressing oneself about it, but this business of summer lands and so on, it sounds very pretty.
Yes.
But of course, you know, there are so many different levels of consciousness.
Yes.
A person is no more, you know, than he thinks.
Yes.
You are exactly what you are from your thoughts and therefore by your actions and your thoughts. You are substantially no more and no less than as you think.
Yes.
And that's why, in my opinion, your world, for instance, if we could get rid, of course, it wouldn't affect me now, but the point is that if it were run by artists and musicians and creative people, breaking down all the barriers between peoples, which politicians invariably build up, and of course not only politicians, unfortunately religion, you know. Religion is a tremendous barrier in some respects.
Yes.
I'm not suggesting there aren't many, many good souls, good people in various religious organizations and also good politicians who mean well in a worldwide sense, not just necessarily for their own particular country, but unfortunately there aren't enough of them.
No.
Far too many people are selfish and only concerned with themselves and what they can obtain or what is good from their own monetary point of view.
Yeah.
You know, the material aspect of things is very distressing, and the way the world is now, you know, we're very concerned about your world.
Oh, I'm
Say, my goodness me, and you know there are thousands of souls returning from the various worlds of the spirit. Yes. Now you take these UFOs, as you term them, these entities that are reaching your world from different sources. You know, I wish I could explain this, but there is a reality in that. You mustn't think this a lot of poppycock, you know.
No.
There are entities on different planets who have a higher standard and attitude of life, a condition of life, and whose desire is to be of service and to help, because there's great fear, well, not fear, that's not the word, but great concern about the state of your world. You know, you girls interest me, because it's quite obvious from what I've been told, what I've learned about you, that you're so immersed in beauty and in loveliness and in music and all the things that are really eternal and lasting. These are the better things of human life, you know. I mean, there's so many things that one has to do in a material world. You have to do the mundane and cope with the ordinary. But the point is, the things that are real and are lasting have given you, no doubt, like many another, great joy and happiness and peace and contentment and tranquility of mind and of spirit are obviously the things of the spirit.
Yes.
And these are the realities. You know. You're very fortunate, you two girls.
We do know. We do know. We really do know.
Very interested in your friend that you recently been to see. Let us sing a Tito.
Yes.
A little bit before my time, well, not quite exactly, but interesting character.
Yes, sir, yes.
Of course, you know Maria Callas, she goes to see him occasionally.
Yes, oh, yes.
But of course, he's not finished yet. No doubt he's got a little while longer to go, you know, some work to do. I hear all about this business of this book.
Yes.
Well, I'm sure that it's going to be a enormous success. But of course, you know, I think the man is taking on too much. It's not for me to say this, of course, and I don't suggest that you say anything to him about it. But from what I've heard from other people who are much nearer and closer to him than I am, of course, I'm only a bystander. I mean, I've been there several times, but there are certain people over here connected and related to him who are very concerned. You know, he's driving himself too hard.
I think that might be
the one. And I think that he ought to ease up for his own health's sake, apart from anything else.
By the way,
he has a daughter, has he not?
Yes, he has.
It's some tragedy there, aren't
you? Yes, indeed. There was.
And I believe this is a very unhappy thing, because there's another man here who was going to connect you with her,
who
died very tragically. And he sends his blessings spiritually on this occasion.
Oh,
and I don't know whether there's some special date around now, but I understand there's some significance in the next few days or week or something. I'm not quite sure exactly about this. I don't normally act as a messenger bearer, but I'm so caught up with you two girls this morning, and there's so many other souls here. And they say to me, while you're there, say so. I really feel as if I'm acting as a spirit guide. Isn't that an extraordinary thing that I should become a guide? Well.
No,
I've heard about familiar spirits. Well, of course, I was in a sense not exactly a familiar spirit to you. I'm here on occasions. Of course, I used to have a familiar spirit who lives out of a bottle when I was on your side. But that's a long time ago, and I've changed a lot since then. I sometimes wish I could take up my baton again on your side.
Yes.
I'd like to, but there you are. That's all in the past, and perhaps who knows, because I'm interested in several people on your side who are doing extremely well in the profession, and I'm trying to help them if I can.
Yes.
But you know, I suppose it's human nature. Well, I suppose I would have been the same under similar circumstances. I wouldn't like someone to, in a way, I would like someone to help me, obviously.
Yes.
We all need help.
Yes.
But you know, we're such vain creatures, we like to think we do it for our own back, don't we? And if someone comes along and says, you know, I helped you on that, you know?
Yes.
You say, oh, did you?
Yes.
You know, I mean, we like to feel we're individual and we, well, we can take help and advice in the initial 4 or 2 years.
Yes.
My goodness me, very necessary. But it doesn't alter the fact that as we get on, I'm not suggesting we think we know it all.
No.
Some of us give that impression. Now, can you hear me? Wood, of course.
Oh, yes.
Wood. Well, I won't go into facts about that, but I mean, I have great regard and great respect for him, you know.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
And we're good friends, yeah.
Yes.
Just his methods and ideas were not altogether mine.
No.
But then again, I didn't hit it off with everybody in the morning. Everybody hit it off with me.
Yes.
Anyway, I think you two girls are going off to America.
Yes, yes, yeah.
Yeah. So I understand in connection with this book.
Yes, yes.
Well, I hope all goes well. I don't want to put a damper on it, but I'm told it's going to be a little sticky as far as Tito's concerned. Don't misunderstand me. I think it will go very well.
Yes.
But you know, he's not as well as he thinks he is, you know.
I see.
I don't know whether I should say this, but I think he should ease up.
Yes.
And I don't know, I suppose anything you or I could do, but he'll go on all right with the thing, but he's going to be a bit of a rush round, isn't he?
Yes, 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 yes. Will you look in and see us in America, sir?
Well, yes, I'll pop in and see you.
Please,
I don't think much of the opera house there.
No,
I suppose I'm prejudiced.
No,
I think when you think back to the old days of the horseshoe and all
that.
Of course, again, I have a longing and a desire for things of the past, inasmuch that to me have such tremendous... tremendous atmosphere. We have replicas of many great buildings, great opera houses.
Yes.
Of course, you know, I speak this must seem to you very odd, well, perhaps it won't, but you know, you take the ancient Greeks, or for that matter, the ancient Romans, or any great, great peoples.
Yes.
Because of their state of mind when they come here, you see, they create in their own environment replicas. You see.
Yeah.
Now, you mustn't think that everyone walks around here in the business suit and the rolled umbrella. That's because they're English.
No.
I mean, some of them wear what I suppose you might call togas, as near as one can describe it. And the more highly advanced souls, it is when you get away from the material image, you get away from the old sort of foggy ideas about London, for instance, or whatever it happens to be, then you enter into a new environment. You've thrown over, as it were, a lot of the old ideas and prejudices and who knows what else, and then you think differently, and in consequence you dress differently, you appear differently. This is what it's all about. Now, for instance, if I were to come back, as I do on rare occasions, like today, for instance, and I were in a position to be able to show myself, which unfortunately I can't do, I might do it from the point of view of thinking, now, I suppose I really should appear to some extent like I was when on Earth,
but
I don't necessarily look like that now.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm much younger in appearance, I don't wear a business suit, I don't wear a tail suit, and I don't walk around with a backup or anything like that. But I might appear something like that to what you call a clairvoyant.
Yes.
You know, just to let them know who I was.
To identify you.
It's a matter of mouth identification.
Yes. Yeah,
see,
sure.
Your mother, for instance, if she passed, shall we say, at 80 or whatever it was, and she came back looking like a beautiful young woman of 23, you'd probably say, oh, goodness me, that's not my mother. Although it does look like my mother as she was when she was very young from those old faded photographs.
Yes.
The whole point is that we have to sort of, in the initial early stages, for instance, of communication such as this, I mean, one has to sort of assert one's personality.
Yes,
one has to come out with statements or facts or whatever it happens to be that will help pinpoint one's personality or to give some idea as to one's reality, claiming to be who one claims to be. But obviously when you get past a certain point and you know that the recipients of the messages that one is giving are already convinced, then you don't bother too much about that. It's what you say, it's the context of your message.
Yes.
And of course we get a little tired. I say we, I'm not so much of myself, because I've not made a habit of coming back too often, and there's no one particularly on your side, relation-wise, that is, that I particularly want to get in touch with. In fact, there were one or two that I was jolly glad to get away from, but we won't go into that. But it's a matter of fact, it's fascinating to know that not only can one enter into the material world temporarily, at least, and pass on some information or some guidance on health. You take your dear friend Maria.
Yes.
I mean, probably if you had said to her, which you may well have done, I'm not saying you haven't, I don't know, during her material lifetime that she was being held by Gary Kirchner or somebody like that, she probably wouldn't have felt too happy about it. One likes to feel that one is an artist and one's own right and that no one else has got anybody else to do with it.
Yes.
And that you work hard and you've striven hard and you've studied hard and heaven knows what else to become what you've become and your voice is yours. And
says,
well, that's all very understandable, of course, but it doesn't alter the fact, you know. There are times when a great artist has got through a performance not altogether on their own wish. This doesn't only apply to singers, it applies to composers, it applies to musicians. In fact, everybody, more or less, in some shape or form, is helped and guided and uplifted and given us an insight, if only they will open up their hearts and their minds to it.
Yes,
you know, I've known the people in the theatre way back. I mean, I go back many, many years before you girls. I think. And I've known actors, one actor in particular, who I had great admiration for, Tree, you know. And of course, he was a bit bombastic and all that. But I've known him when he got to the performance, and it wasn't him at all. Well, I say it wasn't him, it was him, but he was being helped. And he would have been thinking in a suggestion, of course. But did you ever see Trilby? Svengali?
You know the play, of course.
Well,
we never actually saw
it
on the stage.
No, that's fascinating in itself. I'm not saying that it's necessarily happened as such, but I do know of instruments that have been used, singers, who have been much more under an influence than they give themselves credit for.
St. Thomas, may I ask you something?
Yes.
When you first began to speak, and it was rather difficult, it was strangely like your voice. Then you became very fluent. Now, are you helped by somebody else when you speak so fluently?
Well, yes, I suppose in a way one should say yes to that.
Yes.
Because no one really, although they may have set themselves, their personality, or they may be able to get through, and in some instances perhaps their voices, very similar to when it was on Earth, but of course, you see, no one really, this is the thing that people don't understand, that every time I or anyone else comes, it's an artificial reproduction in a sense. The voice box reproduces what one is endeavouring to convey through it, and not only in one's thoughts and one's personality, and the voice itself in a sense must by its very nature be artificial. It cannot be the identical voice of oneself when on Earth you're not using the same physical body, they're not the same language, you're not communicating under the same normal earthly conditions. So obviously in a sense it's a artificially reproduced voice.
And that's why certain voices do sometimes sound rather similar.
There is a similarity, but of course you must also remember that it's not just the one person, in a sense. What I'm trying to convey by this is that as I'm talking to you, there are other entities, souls, friends, who are there to give support, and to give power, and to help. To sustain, you see, that's another thing you don't realize. We have to sustain the energy, sustain the power, at least those whose job it is to do that, the scientifically minded people, the people who work in the background, they have to keep on reproducing or making possible through the energy and the power. You know, I don't know how to explain this. I know it sounds almost stupid in a sort of simile, but I mean, the old-fashioned organ where someone was pumping away like mad, bellows, you know. Well, this isn't a good simile, but while this energy and vibration, whatever it is being pumped into it, then we can hold on.
Well,
but if they were to stop, or if the energy began to fall, or the vitality, or the power from the medium, chiefly, of course, but it's not just that either, of course. A lot of people don't realize this. They just think that the medium is the be-all and the end-all, which in a sense is true and in a sense isn't true. The medium is the person who supplies this extra something which perhaps a lot of people obviously haven't got, but it's not altogether there. We also have a form of energy that is brought into operation.
Yes.
And we have to work, well, at least there's the task, the job it is to sustain this, have to do a great deal in the background to make possible the length of the sitting or the strength of the sitting.
Yes.
Now, there are times, as I'm told, well, I know from experience, when others have tried to communicate, and it's just weak.
Yes.
And the voices, presumably, are very sort of inarticulate. Well, they're not very clear, and they don't assert or can't get over personality. Mm. One of the best communicators I ever remember hearing, I happened to be present at the time, was Oscar Wilde.
Oh, yes.
But of course, he's another changed character. Some people will obviously say, thank goodness for that. The point is that he's charming.
He's
very witty, very brilliant mind.
He's
written quite a number of new works over here. And I always find him a fascinating, interesting companion. Of course, I wouldn't have agreed with lots of things in the old days, but I think back to those early years, and you remember the St. James's Theatre?
Yes.
That was a great show.
Of course.
Had such a background, such a history.
Yes,
many a pleasant evening I'd spent there. You know, it was an extraordinary thing. I think, of course, obviously, for me, I was happiest when I was either playing or talking music, but I love the theatre too, you know. I was very friendly with quite a number of people.
Yes.
Sure, of course, I know well. He's something, really, he's an extraordinary character. He's another one who's changed. Then we all change.
Yes.
And so you two girls, and although you have a lot of knowledge of this subject, and many respects, you've learned a great deal, obviously you'll change.
Yes.
That brother.
Could I ask one question?
Yes, please do, because I think I'll have to go.
Have you seen our friend Neville Cardus?
The critic,
do you remember him at all?
Yes, but I wish I could answer that and say yes, but it wouldn't be right for me
to say yes. Perhaps you haven't yet met
him. I'm sure that he has been met, obviously. Perhaps it's very stinging, it could well be time is no, But I don't know. I don't know my saying. I can say yes to your question. Yes. But I'm sure that wherever he is, he's perfectly happy if he's right. I don't know why I'm showing. I don't know whether this makes sense to you. If it doesn't, well, don't let it worry you. But there's a beautiful floral cross, a deep red roses being placed over your head with white flowers in the background. It's very beautiful. I don't know what the significance is of that, but it's just a moment. It's not a bad sign. It's not anything to worry or
disturb.
It's a beautiful red cross made of roses with white flowers, and it's very artistic and beautiful, and it's symbolic. There's something to do with the near future, and I'm told to tell you all is well.
All is well.
I have to go.
Yes.
I say I'm becoming something like
a
medium's guy.
Yes.
It would do this. Never thought of myself in that light. Anyway, all your dear ones send their love and blessings, and your mum and dad and your brother in particular. Just be happy, girls, and have a good trip. And everything possible will be done. But if you could drop a little, well, of course you won't come.
But
in regard to your friend Tito, out of this American trip, he ought to try and come down a bit and rest in the winter months. Anyway, what can one do? One can't be people. You know, this is true. I think all artists, they're only happy when they're working.
Yes.
Anyway, bye-bye.
Well, goodbye.
God bless you.
God bless you too. Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Oh,
you're
bye-bye. Bless your heart. Thank you. Wonderful talk.
That's extraordinary.
Wonderful.
You just took out.
Yeah.